Hello children, we have finished this particular chapter, the rise of nationalism in Europe, and now today we will discuss the textual questions. Throughout the lesson we discuss the inside questions also while going through the lesson from different topics, different inside questions which could be asked. Today we'll just to go through the question answers from the exercise. So first question, if you see, write notes on five different topics are given there. So first one, Giuseppe Mazzini, you'll find the answer somewhere in page number 12. Here you'll find the answers for, here it's mentioned this last paragraph. So Giuseppe Mazzini was an Italian revolutionary who was born in Geneva in the year 1807. Then he founded the underground societies like Young Italy in Marseilles and Young Europe in Berlin, and the members of that society were like-minded young men from Poland, France, Italy and the German states. He believed that God had intended nations to be the natural units of mankind. Then a patchwork of small states and kingdoms had to be forged into a single unified republic within a wider alliance of nations. He believed, that is, Mazzini believed this. Then this unification could be on the basis of Italian liberty. Then his relentless opposition to monarchy and his vision of democratic republics frightened the conservatives. Even a renowned conservative, Metternich, described him as the most dangerous enemy of our social order. So this many we could write on for a short note to the topic. Next question is Count Camillo di Cava. Here we'll get from page number 21. Most of the answers will get easily from the textbook itself. Here page number 21, if you see the first part itself, certain things it's mentioned about. Chief Minister Cava led the movement of unification of Italy. That person, that is Chief Minister Cava, was neither a revolutionary nor a democrat. Just like the other Italian elite, he also spoke French much better than Italian. So this shows the influence of French language over those particular regions. Then one or two more things you could write on from here itself. That is, he led a tactful diplomatic alliance with France, and then as a result Sardinia appointments succeeded in defeating the Austrian forces in the year 1859. So his role was a prominent one in the unification of Italy. We cannot forget that. So this much we could write up. Then the next one comes the Greek War of Independence. So the Greek War of Independence will get on page number 13. Come to page number 13. Here, third paragraph, if you see, highlighted with the blue color. So here you'll get the Greek War of Independence mobilized nationalist feelings among the educated elite across Europe. Just read it and easily you could modify the sentences. It had been part of the Ottoman Empire since 15th century. A struggle for independence among the Greeks began in the year 1821. Then here four points will get here. Nationalists in Greece got support from other Greeks living in exile and also from many West Europeans. Then poets and artists considered Greece as the cradle of European civilization. They mobilized public opinion to support its struggle against a Muslim empire. Then it was the last we could get go here. The Treaty of Constantinople of 1832 recognized Greece as an independent nation. Enough. That's enough to write about it. Then here next, if we move ahead to Frankfurt Parliament, here we'll get it on page number 17 and 18. So about Frankfurt Parliament, this particular paragraph will get. That is, in the German regions, a large number of political associations came together in the city of Frankfurt and decided. Put it here. Just you have to modify the sentences, shorten certain things. Just pick up the important topics. Came together in the city of Frankfurt and decided to vote for an all-German National Assembly. Then on 18 May 1848, 831 elected representatives marched in a festive procession to take their places in the parliament, Frankfurt Parliament, which was convened in the church of St. Paul. And they drafted a constitution for a German nation to be headed by a monarchy, which was subjected to a parliament. Then other than this, even you could mention about that also, because that is related to Frankfurt Parliament, that is the involvement of women. That is, women played an important role here. That is, a large number of women participated actively there in the liberal movement, but still they did not get that is suffrage right, that is the right to vote. And when this that is here it's given, they were only allowed to observe, they all only allowed as observers to stand in the visitors gallery. Here this part, the beginning part, then the role of women in nationalist struggles, fifth one. So directly what we were talking about, page number 17 itself, the last paragraph, the issue of extending political rights to women was a controversial one within the liberal movement. It was controversial because the women played a very active role there in the movement, but still they were not provided the reasonable or the their due share was not given to them. Here they participated actively. Women had formed their own political associations, they founded newspapers, taken part in political meetings and demonstrations. In spite of that is, despite all these that is all this involvement, their involvement in the movement, suffrage right during the election assembly, during the election of the assembly was not provided to them. And when the Frankfurt parliament was convened, they were only allowed or allowed to enter as observers to stand in the visitors gallery. So this answer gets over here. Next one, what steps did the French revolutionaries, that is the second answer, somewhere here on page number 5, you'll get it on page number 5, here, this part, the second paragraph, you'll get the answer. So the ideas of La Patrie and Les Citoyens, or the ideas of the fatherland and the citizen, emphasize the notion of a united community enjoying equal rights under a constitution. Then the next point, it will be better if you write down this answer, learn this answer point wise, easy for you to remember, and you won't miss anything. A new French flag, the tricolor, was chosen for the purpose. Then the States General was elected by the body of active citizens and was named as National Assembly. New hymns were composed, oaths were taken and martyrs commemorated. Everything in the name of nation. Next point, a centralized administrative system was put in place and it formulated uniform laws for all the citizens in its territory. Then internal customs, duties and dues were abolished. Internal custom duties and dues were abolished, and then uniform systems of weights and measures was adopted. And the last one is, the French became the French was taken as the common language of the nation. All this was done in order to promote a sense of collective identity among the French people. So you'll get the answer up till here, up till this part. Just the only thing is that you have to develop it into the points, the way I told you, write down. Then next one, who were Marianne and Germania? So here this is somewhere on page number 23, if you see, that is towards the end, about the figure of Germania and Marianne. Here Germania's figure is given. This is answer number, page number 23. Here is the picture given. The points will get from here about both. About both will get here, Germania as well as this one, Marianne. First is given here. The female allegories were invented by artists in the 19th century to represent the nation. Here the nations were portrayed as the figures, the female figures, as persons. It was portrayed as persons because the idea of nation was something abstract, which people couldn't relate it to. Okay, so here when this personification was done, it was to give a concrete form to an abstract idea. This is the basic idea behind personifying a nation. So here this part you will get about Marianne, and then here the last one about Germania. So the sentences are very clearly given. You can just sort out the sentences from here itself. Then the next question is trace the process, next one, that is trace the process of German unification. So this also we did it earlier, that is while doing the inside questions. When we are going through the topic, these answers already we have done. Page number 19, this one you will get. Process of German unification, page number 19. Here, page number 19. That is nationalist feelings were widespread among the middle class Germans. Especially who tried to unite the different regions into a nation state, which could be governed by an elected parliament. Okay, and this liberal initiative was repressed. It was not promoted. It was repressed by the combined forces of monarchy and military, and those forces were supported by large landowners who were called Junkers of Russia, of Prussia. Then Prussia took on the leadership of the movement for the unification of the country, that is for national unification. Here comes the involvement of Otto von Bismarck, the chief minister Bismarck. Otto von Bismarck was the architect of this unification. Here he plays a very important role. Bismarck plays a very important role in the formation of, in the unification of Germany. This unification was carried out with the help of Prussian army and bureaucracy. Then you could mention about the three wars which was carried out over a period of 7 years with these three countries, Austria, Denmark and France. And the result of this war was Prussian's victory. Prussia was victorious there in the war, and then the king of Prussia, William I, was proclaimed as the German emperor, which was held at, in a ceremony which was held at Versailles. So this ended with the unification of Germany. Then the fifth one is what changes did Napoleon introduce to make the administrative system more efficient in the territories ruled by him? Here you will find it on page number 6. Page number 6, this particular part. Here you will get what he did. Very clearly mentioned. This part. That is Napoleonic part. He just tried to reform the system to bring some betterment in the administrative part, especially. Even this part or this here, the question can also be raised as the Civil Code of 1804, or either Civil Code of 1804 or Napoleonic Code. It's also called as Napoleonic Code. Any way the question can be asked, the answer will be the same. The particular, that is Napoleonic Code, did away with all privileges which was based on birth. By birth people used to get the privileges, everything was wiped out. It established, with this Napoleonic Code, established equality before the law and secured the right to property. Then the code was exported, even this one we could live here. It abolished the feudal system and freed peasants from serfdom and manorial dues. Then in towns also the guild restrictions were removed. What is this guild restriction? Guild means the associations of merchants, traders, craftsmen, etc. to promote their economic interest. Okay, so here the restrictions were imposed on the associations in terms of trade and manufacturing. So all those restrictions were removed. So it gave the benefit to the merchants, the people involved in the manufacturing industries and all. So it benefited them and it brought economic prosperity there in the region. Then two more things, that is transport and communication systems were improved, and peasants, artisans, workers and new businessmen, they enjoyed a newfound freedom. So with this the question answers we do of the, that is the textual question answers, the first part it gets over. And similarly whatever question answer, whatever inside questions also you are given, just to go through once again, and don't forget to write down all those question answers there in your copy. Fine, thank you.